Well, guess what time it is? It's 5 o'clock on the dot. I'm like, my goodness, if people got to church normally at this time, wow, this would be, but good job, guys. This is amazing. I'm super, super excited for tonight. And I just want to, as we're starting here, I wanted to thank everybody that has poured their heart and their time into making the church as beautiful as it is. These guys back here on our choir, wait until you hear them. Every time they've been doing choir practice, I've been crying. Every time I come in and hear them, I get a touch emotional around this season to begin with, because it's one of my favorite times of the year, favorite time in all of history, to be honest with you. And so when you hear what they're going to be releasing, hopefully it'll touch your heart the same way that it has mine. So I'm excited that you guys are here, that you made the drive in this intense weather to come to Vanguard tonight. What a white Christmas we're going to have, huh? Who's excited about the weather for Christmas? I have a few hands. Then I have a bunch of people that are like, I want snow. I see. There's no snow. We're in New York. I mean, might as well have snow on Christmas. But alas, not this year. So we're going to have to be like it probably was in Jerusalem when Jesus was born. No snow on the ground. Oh, well. Well, thank you for being here. I'm Pastor Justin. This is Pastor Jessica. You are in Vanguard Church, and tonight is going to be an extraordinary night of celebrating this season and celebrating all that it is about and who it is about. And at this point, I'd like to turn it over to my wife.
All right, a couple of housekeeping details before we jump in. We just want to remind everyone to silence your cell phones right now. If you have your cell phone ringer turned on, just so we don't have any loud interruptions to the service. Aside from that, there are restrooms this way or underneath. If you're new here, we just want to make sure that you know you can scoot out the back and go down the stairs, and you will be able to access some restrooms downstairs. If you have an empty seat by you, we want to make sure that there's no empty seats just sitting to waste, because we know we're full today. So just make sure if there's like an empty seat between your group of people, if you scoot over, just to leave the empty one on the edge so that if someone comes in late with their family, they can have a spot to sit. And otherwise, we do have overflow seating downstairs. The service will be streaming down there. If for any reason you need to go downstairs or you have someone coming late that can't find a seat, there's seating down in the Miller Room with the service live streaming down there. So at this point, I just want to welcome you all. Is everyone excited for Christmas? Yeah. Woohoo! I think you guys are going to be blown away tonight. Not to toot my own horn, because I am part of the choir, but Pastor Katie and the choir and the worship team has done an incredible job preparing. Before we get started, do you guys want to just give them a little round of applause to say thank you for all their hard work? I know afterwards you're going to be even more thankful. So if you're excited, just go tell them, thank you so much. That was so powerful. So, and then I want to share really briefly just that I know that you guys all are going to love Pastor Justin's message. And so this season, just a couple key words, if you could leave here with this in your heart, just mulling it around. The word adore. Just tell your neighbor, adore. We are here to adore our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And it is incredible to me. There's a letter that I wrote, and you guys can read that. I'll go through the contents of the bags, but there's a letter that I wrote that explains more in detail my heart and what the Lord downloaded to me about that. But I just want to encourage you, regardless of how many millions of things you have, sometime tonight or tomorrow morning, to take some quiet time, even if it's 10 minutes, just to spend time in your heart adoring your Savior, Jesus Christ, and our Heavenly Father who gave us His beloved Son so that we would have eternal life. And so we're going to pray and begin the program. So you want to pray us in?
So if you would bow your head and close your eyes with me. Jesus, first and foremost, we say thank you. Thank you that You came for a reason, and you came with intention. You came to do something that had never been done, and you accomplished it. Today, that our hearts would be full of wonder. This evening, that we would feel a touch from the Most High, that we would feel your presence in this room as it makes its way from every seat through every row. Tonight is a night where we look to you, the God of wonder. Thank you for what you've done. Tonight, we celebrate you. In your name, amen.
Shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." They hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph, and there was the baby lying in the manger. After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherd's story were astonished. But Mary kept all these things in her heart and thought about them often. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them.
Yeah. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born the King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the peoples, chief priests, and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. And they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
At this time, we'd like to ask all of you in the congregation to join us in singing Joy to the World. Would you please stand?
We will sing. And I saw the Lamb approach the throne and receive the scroll from the right hand of the one who sat there. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood, out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth." Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, the living creatures and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, I heard saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and evermore."
Hallelujah.
not sure how you follow that. I'm like, we'll just call the service right there, and it would be a great Christmas service. Thank you guys so much. I hope you could feel his presence in that moment. That is the reason we're here at Vanguard. That is the reason why we do what we do, is to open up a door for everybody to step into a place of interacting with him. That's why we're here. He makes me wonder how he does this, what he does inside of me in these moments, what he does inside of me all day. It makes me wonder. As we were coming into this Christmas season, I had a bit more wonder. As I was sitting there pondering Mary and pondering this concept of the Immaculate Conception, we'll leave it simple at that because there's children in here too, but this concept of this woman who has this child inside of her by God, I began to wonder about this. Like, it began to hit me. Oh my goodness, he defied the laws of nature. He literally broke the very laws that he had set up. He broke the laws of nature to do something extraordinary that had never been done, had never been seen, had never been understood before. And I started to think, why? Why did he do that? And I think one of the people that was a predecessor to Mary in that lineage was King David. He was a man that wondered at these crazy things too. He was a man who was legendary in and of himself. There's so much that's written about him. And yet he was one of the most unusual characters in the Bible. One of the wildest, because he saw past the laws. He saw past all of the traditions that they had built through the temple worship, through all the different things that had come from God, through Moses. He saw something more intense. He saw this mystic. David was a mystic. He saw this distant God, this possibility of who this person could be, this possibility of who this living being, this creator was. And it was through a mist. It was foggy and it was unsure, but he began to step into it. He began to tap into it. When there were all the laws that told us about what we were to do and what would happen if we didn't do them, David wrote these crazy poems. And in these poems, he said things like, though I make my bed in hell, still you're there with me. Though I try to run as far as east is from the west, still you find me there. David caught a glimpse of this God. He actually caught a glimpse of this Jesus that was to come, that was to set the record straight. He saw a God that was outside of the laws, outside of even the laws of nature. He saw God do extraordinary things. So as I began to wonder more about Mary, more about the Immaculate Conception, more about the fact that this God of the universe defied and broke even his own laws of creation to do this thing, I began to think even further, and I began to think of this baby that became a man. And I began to think of this man and how he went about his life. And as he went about his life, he defied the very laws that were set before him. He was a man who had said, don't touch the unclean or you will become unclean. And what did he do? He found the leper and he touched him and he was made whole. It said not to hang around loose women or women that did things that made them unclean. Back in the day, there were all kinds of things that made you unclean. And guess where he would be found? He would be found laying his hands on a prostitute and bringing her back to life. And in that moment, doing what his law forbade him to do. And the same Jesus would find himself at home with those that probably a lot of us might feel uncomfortable around. Anybody ever spent time with the mafia? Don't raise your hands. Matthew, tax collector, he was mafia of that day. He was hated by everybody, the Jews and the Romans. And Jesus brings him in to the closest place he can to himself as he says to him, come, follow me. He's defying the very laws of how things should be done, how they should be built, how you should build a successful church. He breaks every rule, every single one of them. And then it says of him that he would be found at home with the tax collectors, the mafia. He would be found at home with the drunks. He would be found at home around women that nobody was supposed to be around. And there he was, laying his hands on them. There he was, defying the very rules and regulations that set up a society. And I asked myself again and again, why? Why? In this season, I just wonder. I want want to give you an answer to why. I shared some of this on Sunday, but I want to share this again. Jesus defines love in a way that is extraordinary, that surprised me when I heard it. He said of love, no greater love has a man than this. You ready for this? No greater love. Some people, if you're not too sure what the scripture says, you might think maybe he's going to talk about the love of a father for a child or a mother for a child. Maybe that's the kind of love he's going to talk about when he's about to finish this sentence. But no, he doesn't say that the greatest love is the love of a father or a mother, which is kind of shocking to me because Jesus talks so much about the Father. And he goes and maybe it's the kind of love that brothers and sisters share, or brothers, or maybe it's the kind of love that you would have in a family of some form. Maybe it's the kind of love that a husband and a wife share, that intense matrimonial bond. But he doesn't use any of those to describe the greatest love. He says this, no greater love has a man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. See, when I was sitting there pondering about Mary, pondering why God did all the things that he did, why he broke even his own laws. He broke his laws of creation in order to bring about his son. He broke the very laws of not touching this and being unclean so that he could touch the people. And I began to think, why? And I'll tell you this because this is for you and this is for me. He wants to be in relationship with you.
Yes.
He wants to actually be your friend.
Yes.
There were only two people in the entire Old Testament called friends of God, Moses and Abraham. And yet, in the New Testament, suddenly Jesus calls this group of 12 men, and multiple women, by the way, that were following him too, and he looks at these people, his disciples, and he says to all of them, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. The God of the universe broke through every boundary that could humanly be created, even the ones that he created, for one purpose. Some people are like, yes, to forgive us of our sins. No, that was secondary. He did do that, and he did a really good job of that. But first and foremost, he broke through every boundary for one reason. So that he could call you his friend. And I want to encourage you today, if you don't know him as your friend, the church has done you wrong. I'm going to make that really clear because the church doesn't seem to teach Jesus as a friend or God as a friend. There's some really broken concepts out there about who he is, but I'll tell you one thing. If you've ever had a best friend, do they stick with you through everything? If you've had a best friend, I have had the very amazing fortune of having a few best friends in my life, currently do. And I have found one thing to be true. My worst days, they're there.
Yes.
My best days, they're there. I can't, this is going to sound horrible, but I'm going to say this anyways. I can't sin enough to get these dudes away from me. I mean it. They'll literally hunt me down if they see me doing rough. If they see me having a bad day, they're coming to find me. Best marriages in life, the best husband and wife combinations are those that are best friends.
Yes. Yep.
The best father and son, father and daughter, mother and son, mother and daughter relationships that are out there, because my kids, they don't have a choice. They have to be my kids. These poor guys up here, my son and daughter, well, they're not poor. They actually are super blessed, but we're not going to go there. But they don't have a choice. They are my son and daughter. But the greatest day I have is when they look at me and they say, I actually count you as a And I want to tell you today that what made me wonder was this simple truth that I began to see clearer than anything else, especially through Jesus, especially why we celebrate this season. He came to bring us in to the greatest place of relationship we could ever have. It changes everything. It restores everything. He's so comfortable with you where you are right now. I hope you heard that. Some people think you got to jump through a million loops to be able to get close to God. And I want to tell you this. He's sitting right next to you.
Yes.
Might be sitting on your family member or a friend, but he's sitting right next to you. Right now. There's nothing that you can do that can change that fact. And I'm telling you this, whether you've accepted Jesus as your Savior or not, right now, God is right there next to you, looking and longing for you to turn your eyes to Him. And He wants to introduce you into a relationship with Him that is unlike anything you've ever had. He wants you to be His friend, friend of God. So I want to leave that with you today. As you wonder about this season, I want the church, we represent the church, all of Vanguard represents the church here, even if this is not your home church, to one another, I hope we represent friendship in a way that is the picture of God. And to those of you here that have never heard this before, or that have had the church do you wrong because they haven't taught you that Jesus came to actually become a friend and to open the door for people to become friends of God, I want you to know today that He longs to be your friend, and He longs to call you His friend. He came here to restore a relationship that had been lost. Relationship that had been lost with Him. He came here to this earth, defied the laws of creation, defied even the religious laws of that day for one reason, so that He could look you in the eye at the end of the day and say, one, will you be my friend? And then for the rest of us that have already said, yes, He's our friend, He looks at you and He says, I'm so glad that you've chosen to be my friend. So, I want you to pray this with me really quick. I would like everybody to join me in this prayer. If you could bow your head and close your eyes. And I want you to say this simple prayer. Jesus, I want to know what it means to be your friend.
I want to know what it means to be your friend.
I want to build that relationship that looks like friendship.
I want to build that relationship that looks like friendship.
I want to understand why you came to this earth.
I want to understand why you came to this earth.
And I want to understand why you laid your life down. That you could call me friend. I just speak blessing over everybody in this place today for that purpose. To be known by you and to know you as a friend. In your name, amen. Thank you for letting me share today.
Amen. And if, I think the ushers are ready. If you prayed that prayer, and that was maybe the first time you prayed that prayer, that was new to you. The ushers have a book for you, and it's called The Case for Christmas. And it's really good. It helps open that up, that relationship with Jesus. So if that's you, just raise your hand, and the ushers will just give you that book. And it just opens up, because it's all about relationship. It's all about new. So just lift up your hand real quick, and they'll give you that book. So bless you. Or if you want to know more, I don't know how many we have, Pastor Jessica. Well, I don't think, maybe not all the kids, but hey. Anyone else just want to know more about Christmas and what it means with a relationship? I can't see any hands anyway, so I'm just. Okay. So as they're doing that, I have the opportunity to take up the offering tonight. And you may say, well, opportunity, don't you mean I have the obligation today? And I love being able to give, and I'm growing in that in my life. But with this church, because this, God has just released generosity in this church, and I know I see it as being on, you know, the board and what the people do in their generosity and giving. And if you want to know a little bit about Vanguard, what we're going after, like Pastor Justin just said, is not about form, not about obligation, not about, well, you have to give today, but it's all coming from the heart. And that's what God's heart towards us, when He sent His most precious gift, right? It was from His heart so that we could know Him. And that's what we're after. And giving is the same way. God's not after forcing us, but it's after a heart that gives, a heart that wants to look like our Heavenly Father, who is a generous giver. And so that's what we're after, to be generous givers as well. So this year, again, we're just dedicating the whole offering tonight to two ministries that I think express the heart of God so beautifully in just reaching out to people. The first one is for New Hope, and that's the ministry that we have that we support for India. And I think it's been really 40 years that we've pretty much, we've supported this ministry, and Hadith and her family is so integral in leading this right now. And it does so much in India, but this specific offering tonight is going to go towards purchasing saris for the women over in India that are really in need. And so saris are their traditional clothes that they wear. Sometimes some of the women maybe only have one that they wear for the whole year. And it's so this is an opportunity to be a blessing to the people over that are in need. And I don't know how to say, how much does a typical sari cost? Okay. Okay. So they're about $15 to $20 each, and that will take care of someone so they have just clothes to wear. And we'll show a video in a second, but it's an awesome way to just sow into the lives of people and just share the love of God. And the second ministry that we're supporting is Let Them LOL, Let Them Laugh Out Loud. And that, I believe, is a ministry, I think it started in Clarence, New York, and it does a few things, but one of the main things it does is it goes around the world and digs wells for people that are in need of just basic water. And it's amazing that we could have an opportunity to help people get water. And so this is a ministry that also, I think, shares the heart of God in giving and meeting people's needs. And God's given us, he's blessed us. The blessing that we have is to be able to be shared with other people. So just a couple ways to give, and then we'll watch the video. But to me, the easiest way is text giving. And it's 84321. I think it'll be up here in a little bit. But you can just type your amount and Christmas Eve, and that will show you, that will allow you to give. And if you've not done it before, you can put your information in. We're passing the, I guess they're bags these days, they're not plates anymore, and so that as well. Or you can go online and give at vanguard.church, so as well. So let's show a video just a little bit to show where and what the impact of your giving tonight will be. Our ushers could come forward just as we pray. Lord, we just thank you for your blessing. We thank you, Lord, that as we receive, we can just give out, Lord. We pray for just a powerful impact, Lord, on our friends in India and around the world, Lord, as we give tonight, Lord. We just give to you with a joyful heart. We just thank you because your heart joyfully gives. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Wow. I am so excited. I know we're coming towards a couple last pieces of the program, but I just want to take a minute as you guys are giving your offering to go through the Christmas bags that you received when you first came in. We love giving gifts here at Vanguard, in case you don't know us. And so I'm going to quickly just highlight a few things in here. You can have fun going through it. This envelope is the Christmas letter that I told you guys about. I really encourage you. As I was writing that, I was weeping. The Holy Spirit came on me. Pastor Katie read it and a few others. I said, you know, how does this hit you? And they were hit with the Holy Spirit weeping. So I just encourage you, take this into your prayer time tonight or tomorrow morning and just allow the Lord to encounter you as you read it. Of course, there's a couple little things, a bookmark of Vanguard and some goodies. But the main thing I want to highlight, we got some cute candies and whatnot. The main thing I want to highlight is this ornament. Every year we do a handmade ornament. And people, primarily this year was Kristen, did the heavy lifting on this one. But people hand make these ornaments for you guys. And so this year's theme, it is Tell It, because, and there's a write-up about that in there as well. You can read what the Lord's been speaking to us in 2021 about evangelism and the need for people to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. So this is just a fun little reminder for those of you that did not come early. You didn't hear a little preview, but we're going to be ending with Go Tell It on the Mountain. And so this is a mountain that says Tell It, and it's just a beautiful reminder for you of this night and of the great commission that Jesus gave to us to bring the good news to the earth and to help lead his children back to him. So thank you for joining us for that. And then we are going to ask you to begin the candle lighting. So ushers, if you could come forward and get the candle. So you received candles all when you came in. I should have brought up two candles, but if you want to make sure, we don't want candle wax everywhere, so the lit candle needs to stay upright. We do have these great plastic shields, but the lit candle needs to stay upright, and then the unlit candle, you can scooch it open so the plastic is away from the wick, and you just tilt it and light it, and then you'll light your neighbors. Your neighbor with their unlit candle will lean it up to your lit candle, and we'll go along the row that way. When you're done, just again, blow it out while it's upright, and that way, keep holding it for a minute or two so the wax can set, and that way you'll be able to clap your hands in the last song because you're going to want to do that. So we're going to sing Silent Night, and we'd like you all to join in with us. And so please stand as we light the candles and sing Silent Night. Thank you. Well, I know there's no place that I would rather be tonight than here right now. We hope that you have enjoyed this evening. We have one last number that we're going to do before we close out. But I know even just the room, I don't know if you got to look around at all the lights, just to take a moment and just take it all in. I know a lot of times we're too distracted. So it's been such a beautiful night, and we're just gonna pray. We wanna encourage you to visit the photo booth in the pass-through here before you head out and get a family photo. And
yeah, and I don't think, there we go, okay. And I want to, like Jessica said, encourage you guys. There's a photo booth over here. It's a new backdrop we have. It's a really large one. You can fit your whole family in there. It'd be great for family photos or friends' photos. And so have fun with that. And I want to pray to bring us into the next song. And then we'll finish up with this song. So Father, Son, Holy Spirit, we say thank you. Thank you for this amazing, wonderful season that is so full of awe as we come here and realize that God came to earth, the Emmanuel, God with us, that you longed so much for us to know who you were, that you broke through every boundary to do so, and that with that in our hearts and in our minds, that it would fill us up with such joy, such hope, that we would go tell it, that we'd go tell people, I need to tell you about this person. I need to tell you about this God. I need to tell you what has changed my life. I need to tell you. I need to tell you. I need to tell you. Even as the disciples, when they met Jesus for the first time, they ran to tell their brothers, you got to meet this guy. You got to meet this guy. They had to tell everybody because they were changed by this guy, Jesus Christ. And so we celebrate you tonight. And that it would be in our hearts, in our minds, it would be upon our lips, the joy and the wonder of this season, and that it would come forth out of us to those around us. In your name.
Go tell it.
And with that, we want to wish you all a very Merry Christmas. Thank you for being here tonight. Don't forget about the photo booth. And good job, kids. You guys did amazing. You did amazing. Woo, and choir, thank you. Oh, my gosh. And our choir director, thank you. Love on somebody.